As many of you come to the museum regularly, you've probably noticed that we are undergoing a lot of exciting new programs and a big transformation and evolution, adding a larger number of new exhibitions and programs to our existing program, providing often more contemporary perspectives. Another way, of course, of doing this as well is in examining our history and finding new ways to engage with the material in our collections through programs such as Repetition and Difference, which is on here on the second floor, or Masterpieces and Curiosities, which you can see on the third floor. Warhol's 10 Portraits of Jews of the 20th Century is a work that was last shown here at the museum in 2008 and includes portraits of the figures that you see here on the screen. When I began working here about 3 years ago, I started familiarizing myself with the collection, and this was a work that I was particularly fascinated with because it included some of my all-time favorite Jewish characters and personalities, including Gertrude Stein, Albert Einstein, Kafka, and of course, the Marx brothers. What I thought was interesting about this piece was that Andy Warhol, when he made the piece, actually never met any of those personalities, and I was eager to figure out a way of like how I could meet them. And this is the way that the series Wish You Were Here was born. And I thought, like, how could I actually meet them? And of course, they're all dead by now. So I started investigating, and a lot of ideas were proposed to me. Sort of soul-to-soul communication, Ouija boards, and all kinds of other things. But of course, in the end, I thought the most appropriate way would be to actually invite personalities and people who are experts, who are scholars in the work of these personalities, and have them come and respond to my questions in the first person. So we have had so far visits by Sigmund Freud, Sarah Bernard, and Gertrude Stein, and tonight we are welcoming one of the Marx brothers, Groucho Marx, and Groucho has actually brought with him a special guest who will appear during our conversation. And Groucho Marx speaks tonight through the actor Noah Diamond. Noah Diamond is a writer and performer, and he has a long association with the Marx brothers. He spent the last 5 years researching and adapting the famous Lost musical of the Marx Brothers, which they performed in 1924. And it's the only musical that wasn't turned into a movie. And it's called I Will Say She Is It, She Is. Noah set this musical up in 2004 at the New York International Fringe Festival, and it returned to the stage here in New York in 2016. Noah has also authored a book about the resurrection of that musical called Give Me a Thrill that will reveal the show's 19-year history. And his Marx-inspired New Yorker cover design was printed in the magazine's 95th anniversary issue. So Noah has a long history of playing Groucho Marx on and off stage, and I'm very happy to have him joining us tonight. With tonight's program, I want to investigate Groucho's life, the Marx Brothers' career, and also look a little bit into the comedic legacy in relation to today's comedy with Groucho right here, so he can also respond to your questions or criticisms. And we're going to hand out little note cards with little pens, and you can write down questions for Groucho that we will collect and that I will ask Groucho to answer. Before we continue, I would like to take this opportunity to thank Noah Diamond and also Zach Selden for agreeing to be part of this experiment. And there's two people here at the museum that I would like to thank in particular, which are Jenna Weiss, who is our manager for public programs, and also Dan Palmer, our Leon Levy assistant curator. Both have worked very closely with me in organizing this Wish You Were Here series, and it wouldn't happen without them. So please take a moment to turn off your cell phones and join me in welcoming Groucho Marx.
Yeah. Well, thank you. I certainly am grateful for this magnificent washout, turnout, and I am highly gratified at this magnificent display of effusion. On second thought, this is one of the frowsiest looking joints I've ever seen. Where do you get your wallpaper? You're letting this place run down, and what's the result? You're not getting the class of people that you used to. Well, you've got people here now that look like you. I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll put up a sign outside, placed under new management. Set up a 75-cent meal that'll knock their eyes out. After we knock their eyes out, we can charge them anything we like. Do you realize you haven't stopped talking since I came here? You must have been vaccinated with a phonograph needle. Hello, did you say your name was Jens Hoffmann?
Yes.
Well, I guess a Hoffman is better than none.
Thank you so much for coming.
I'm kidding you, Jens. I think you're doing a wonderful job.
One of the things I noticed is when I invited you that you actually used to live very close to here
on
93rd Street, which is just like a block away from here.
I was born on 78th Street. And when I was about 5 years old, we moved to 93rd between 3rd and Lexington and lived there for about 14 years.
I heard something that you said, like that the family always thought it was cheaper to move rather than to pay the rent.
This is true. Until I was 5 years old, we moved constantly because, yes, the rent bill would come and we would have to move. It was cheaper to move than to pay the rent. Then we'd move to another apartment. The same thing would happen again, another rent bill. So we had to keep moving, but we stayed on 93rd Street for a while, and I had a great boyhood there. We were poor, but unhappy.
Here's your family in 1912.
It's quite a group of them.
Tell us, how was it to grow up during that period?
Well, it was a much simpler time, you know. Yorkville was dominated by breweries in those days. There were two major breweries in the East 90s. One was called Rupert's, and the other was called Errett's. And many members of my family and many of my neighbors worked in those two breweries. The streets smelled of beer, if that's your idea of a good time.
Here's your mom and pop.
Yeah.
Tell us about them.
They were wonderful folks. My father, Sam Marx, but they called him Frenchie. He was from Alsace-Lorraine, and he was a bit of a Frenchman. As you can see, a very dapper dresser with a very neatly trimmed mustache. He was a tailor, and a very bad one. Frenchie always thought that only the crudest of hacks would resort to so pedestrian a tool as a tape measure, and insisted that he could size a customer up just by looking at him. And as a result of Frenchie's intuition, Yorkville was full of men walking around with one sleeve longer than the other, dragging an inch of pant leg behind them as they walked. But although he was not talented at his chosen field, he did have a hidden skill, and that was in the kitchen. My father was the best cook who ever lived. And even when we were very poor, Frenchie could take a couple of short ribs and some wilted cabbage and concoct a stew fit for a king. In fact, our career took off largely because Frenchie would cook for all the showbiz bookers. My mother would bring them around and one taste of Frenchie's stew and they would book the Marx Brothers. Minnie was my mother, Minnie Schoenberg. She was from Germany, from a little town called Dornum. And she was the true hero of the family. She was our manager in the early days, a great woman. And I attribute the success of the Marx Brothers to Minnie's belief in us.
Here's you and Groucho, you and Harpo very early on. You mentioned that this might have been at the Bar Mitzvah.
Yes, I'm not sure if it was that event or another one. But yes, as you can see, that's me on the left, and another boy I was friends with holding Harpo on the right. We were real cute, weren't we?
Do you remember where the photograph was taken?
I believe this is on the steps of our building, 179 East 93rd Street. It's still there. You can go and see it. The rent has gone up a bit.
Another personality that we're going to interview in this series, wish you were here, is George Gershwin. And someone told me that you guys were actually neighbors with Gershwin, and that's how Chico got started playing the piano. Is that true?
Well, not exactly. The Gershwins did live in the same neighborhood, but either not at the same time as us, or we didn't realize it. But of course, Gershwin was one of the great composers. We got to know them later in the 1920s, during our Broadway period, and never worked with Gershwin. But I used to have a cup of coffee with him once in a while, or as we said, a Rhapsody in Brew. You're not getting your money back.
This is you in a wonderful young age here, quite a handsome man.
What a dapper gentleman. Yes, that's a celluloid collar. Ideal for concealing Adam's apples. We were always pretending to be younger than we really were, because if you were younger, if you were under 12 years old, it was cheaper to ride the train. And when we were touring in the early days, my mother would always try to get the least expensive ticket she could. So she would say, "These are my boys. They're 10, 9, 8, and 7. And the conductor would come around and take the tickets, and I was in the men's room shaving. And Chico was making a play for a dame across the aisle.
The mysterious Gummo.
My brother Gummo. Gummo is the next brother, the next one born after me, and he and I are very close. Gummo was in the act in the beginning. The four Marx brothers were originally Groucho, Hoppo, Chico, and Gummo. But Gummo left the act and joined the army. He served bravely in Illinois. And after that, decided that he was through being in show business, too. He became my agent later on. Gummo Marx was my manager. He was actually named Milton, but seemed like such a silly name. This is the Nightingales period.
Yeah, tell us about the beginnings.
Yes, well, I got started in show business because of my uncle. I had a famous uncle. His name was Al Sheen. He was my mother's brother. And Al Sheen was a great vaudeville comedian. Later, he teamed up with Ed Gallagher. They were Gallagher and Sheen. Oh, Mr. Gallagher, what's on your mind this morning, Mr. Sheen? That was my uncle. He was a German comedian. He did a German character and was known as a Dutch comic. You know what a Dutch comic is. That's a comedian who splits the check equally at dinner. And I was so inspired by him. He was easily the most glamorous and exciting person in my little world. So when I became a comedian, I also did Dutch. And I sang songs like, "Ist das nicht ein Schnitzelbank?" And if this was a German audience, you all would have said, "Ja, das ist ein Schnitzelbank." It's a good thing you aren't. We would have had to do the whole song. So that's me at the top in my Hans Pumpernickel German character. I played a butcher boy. And down under me next is Hoppo, then Gummo. And the boy on the bottom is someone else. His name was Lou Levy. He was not one of my brothers, but he was in the act for a number of years, Lou Levy. This was before Chico came on board. Ah, well, there's the four Marx brothers. Left to right, Groucho, Chico, Hoppo, and Gummo. Look at Chico's face. Would you trust that man? Chico was the gambler of the family, and very irresponsible. He was the oldest of the Marx brothers, and he was Minnie's favorite. And he carried throughout his life this sense of entitlement and was always looking for a thrill. He was always looking for a place where he could find a card game or perhaps a easily convinced woman. There were three things Chico was always on: a phone, a horse, or a broad.
How did you guys get your stage names?
The stage names came in 1914. We were playing Galesburg, Illinois, in vaudeville, and we were playing poker backstage with a comedian named Art Fisher. He was a vaudeville monologist. And at that time, there was a comic strip that was extremely popular by Gus Mager. And it was called Mager's Monks, and it was a series of strips about monkey characters who were called monks, and they all had names that ended in O, you know, like Yanko the dentist, Sherlocko the detective. And there was a character called Groucho. And because of the popularity of this strip, vaudeville was full of bangos and knockos and sloppos and wackos. It was a real trend at the time. And so as this comedian, Art Fisher, was dealing cards, he thought it would be funny to call me Groucho. Here's one for Groucho. Because I always had a sunny and kind personality. And he went around the table. My brother Arthur, he was born Adolf, called himself Arthur, but he played the harp, so calling him Hoppo made a lot of sense. And my brother Chico was always chasing chicks. Called him Chico, and it's pronounced Chico, it was spelled with a K originally. Gummo always wore gumshoes, even when it wasn't raining. So he was called Gummo. And then years later, when our baby brother Zeppo joined the act, we called him Zeppo for a number of reasons, none of them true.
How did you make the transition from vaudeville and theater to the silver screen?
Very uneasily. It was a difficult transition to make. The truth is, our career mostly took place on the stage. We were touring in vaudeville. My first job was 1905. In fact, I remember in 1906 performing at a benefit for the victims of the San Francisco earthquake at the Metropolitan Opera House. I mean, the benefit was at the Opera House, not the earthquake. By far, the largest and classiest room I had ever played. We were on Broadway through 1929. So by the time we got to films, it was practically over for us. You know, living in Beverly Hills in a mansion, playing golf and making one picture a year, that was retirement. The stage was our real career. We tried to make a silent film in 1921. It was called Humor Risk. It's lost. Don't look for it. I'm afraid you might find it. The real transition for us was from vaudeville to Broadway. That was when we knew we had made it. The difference between vaudeville and Broadway is difficult to explain today. It was going from the small time to the big time. Even the Palace wasn't Broadway. It is now.
Tell us about your first film that the brothers made.
The first film we made that was actually released and seen was called Coconuts. Coconuts was based on our second Broadway show. It was written by Irving Berlin and George Kaufman. We had had a big success in 1924 with I'll Say She Is. That was our first Broadway show. We toured for a year in it, opened on Broadway, and no one expected the Marx Brothers to work on Broadway. It was expected that we would run for a couple of weeks and then very quickly move on and go back to touring as we had for all those two decades leading up to that time. But unexpectedly, the big New York critics, people like Wolcott and Benchley and George Jean Nathan, thought that we were the greatest comedians they'd ever seen. And that was what made the Marx Brothers a phenomenon. I'll Say She Is. It's being done again next year. You'll be able to see it at the Connolly Theater. After that, we were very hot, and everybody wanted to work with us. We could get the top draw talent like Irving Berlin and George Kaufman to write our next show. Much to Kaufman's frustration, the Marx Brothers were always ad-libbing. We would rewrite our parts on stage every night. In fact, there's a famous story that one day Kaufman was backstage, and he was talking to a friend, and he was distracted for a moment. And he said, pardon me, I'm sorry, I just thought I heard one of the original lines. He was a brilliant man, George Kaufman. He wrote three shows for us, two shows in one picture. And you know, Kaufman was famous as a show doctor. He would, when a show was in trouble, they would call in George Kaufman and he would take a look at it and tell them what was wrong and maybe do a little rewriting. Well, the manager of Bloomingdale's department store decided to get into show business at one point and produce a show. And it was in upstate New York in Buffalo trying out and doing very badly. So they decided to call in George Kaufman to see if he would be a show doctor on this play. Kaufman watched the show. Afterwards, the producer eagerly met with the great playwright. Said, what do you think, George? Kaufman said, I'll tell you what you do. Close the show and keep the store open nights.
This is a picture of animal crackers.
Yes. Can you find Groucho Marx in this picture? Animal Crackers. Animal Crackers was our third Broadway show and our final Broadway show. Animal Crackers was written by Kaufman and Maury Riskind with a score by Kalmar and Ruby. When we did Animal Crackers on stage, there was a moment where they needed a break for a set change. And they had to do a number in one, that means in front of the curtain. And you know, they were, usually would bring out two young lovers and they'd sing a beautiful love song and then the curtain would open on the next set. But at this point, they didn't have any material and they asked if I would do something at this point in the show to fill 2 minutes for a set change. So I decided to write a poem. And I thought I would recite the poem during this break, and I wrote a ridiculous poem. And on Broadway, we did Animal Crackers for a sophisticated New York audience, like this one. Only sophisticated. And they thought it was very funny. But then later, as the show continued and we started to get more of the tourist trade, and then later when we took it on the road, they thought I was serious. They received it as a serious work of poetry. The beginning was, did you ever sit and ponder as you walk along the Strand that life's a bitter battle at the best? And if you only knew it and could lend a helping hand, then every man could meet the final test. The world is but a stage, my friend, and life is but a game, and how you play is all that matters in the end. For whether a man is right or wrong, a woman gets the blame. And your mother is your dog's best friend.
Tell me a little bit about Seppo. Why did he quit in 1933 to appear in the films?
Seppo was sort of a replacement. He joined the act in 1918 when Gummo left because Minnie wanted to keep the name of the four Marx brothers intact. And so Seppo just stepped in gamely as the fourth brother. At that point, he was divided from a thriving career as a juvenile delinquent. By the time Zeppo joined the act, there were already three comedians on board who had developed their characters over the years and were full of confidence and were his older brothers. So Zeppo never really had a chance to be anything other than a sort of affable, juvenile character. So he left the act after Duck Soup in 1933 and went on to become an agent and an inventor, and he did a lot of things. When we met with Irving Thalberg, after we finished our first five pictures at Paramount, we went to MGM to work for Irving Thalberg. And Thalberg took a meeting with us, and he asked us, will three Marx brothers want to be paid the same as four Marx brothers? I said, don't be ridiculous. Without Zeppo, we're worth twice as much. But I, he's not here, is he?
Talking about Duck Soup, one of my favorite scenes is from Duck Soup, the mirror scene, and I just wanted to play from that, and maybe we can talk a little bit about that afterwards.
Absolutely.
Oh yeah, here is a famous picture.
The mirror scene, in fact, a great deal of the physical comedy.
We're on the house.
Well, that scene is really a tribute to my brother Harpo, who is probably my favorite person in the world. You know, Harpo inherited all of my mother's good qualities, kindness and understanding. Harpo! Well, this is a surprise. Hey, please, don't hurt the poor girl. Can't you see she doesn't know what she's doing? Come on up here. I'm terribly sorry. I don't know. Won't you go back to your seat? We didn't know. Harpo, please, leave the poor woman alone. All right, stay there. I'm going out for something to drink.
I just came to see the art.
You can go back to your seat, dear. Hoppo, come here. Come over here. I want you to meet my friend. This is Jens Hoffmann. Well, I guess you thought I could use a hand. Here, stand, shake hands with my brother Hoppo. I was telling you, Hoppo inherited all my mother's good qualities, and I got what was left. Now then, Hoppo, it's wonderful to see you. I didn't expect this. But we're trying to conduct an interview here. Perhaps you could let us have some peace. Oh, that's the program for tonight's festivities, or ordeal, if you prefer. He gets mad because he can't read. Well, it's a pleasure to see you, Hoppo, but we'd like to proceed with our little chat here, so if you would just let us have some peace, we'll get along, and I'll talk to you after the show. No, those are peas. Not. I said, can we have some peace, please, Hoppo? Those are peas. Now, what do you have there? I don't understand what you're doing. This looks like a lease. No, that's a lease. I'm asking if we could have some peace so that we can continue our conversation, if that's what it is. Now, that's a fleece, Hoppo. That looks like a fleece to me. Now then, if we could have some peace and just get ahead with what we're doing, we can... Oh, fleas. Looks like you've got fleas. I see. Well, that doesn't... No, that's a sneeze. Well, thank you very much, Hoppo. Perhaps we'll speak to you in a little while. It's wonderful to see you. My brother Hoppo, ladies and gentlemen. That's as grisly a looking object as I've ever seen. If I'm not mistaken, we had... That'll keep him busy for a while. If I'm not mistaken, we both had the same mother.
Wanted to talk to you about another Marx Brothers regular, Margaret Dumont.
Ah.
She was called the fifth Marx Brother.
Yes, indeed.
She appeared in seven of your films, if I'm not mistaken.
I believe that's true, yes. She was a great lady. She was a great comedian. You know, if we were great comedians, then she was a great comedian and a very important part of our act. Margaret Dumont was very much like the character she played. As a matter of fact, we used to name her based on the classiest hotel in whatever city we were playing. Because she always played this dignified dowager character. And that's where Mrs. Rittenhouse came from. We were playing Philadelphia. And the big hotel at the time was the Hotel Rittenhouse. And we thought that would be a good thing to call Margaret Dumont because she looked like a hotel. Now, she happened to be an extremely beautiful woman and a very important part of the act. And the last show she ever did was with me on the Hollywood Palace. We recreated the opening scene from Animal Crackers. She said, Rittenhouse Manor is entirely at your disposal. She wished she hadn't said that.
Let me show you one more clip here, one of my other favorite ones.
Got all the Hoppo's. I'm sitting on Hoppo's peas and Hoppo's fleece.
This is from a Night at the Opera.
A Night at the Opera. That was the first film we made for Irving Thalberg, 1935.
Well, that's fine. That steward is deaf and dummy. Let her know you're in here.
Oh, sure. That's all right.
Yes?
We've come to make up your room.
Are those my hard-boiled eggs?
I can't tell until they get in the room. Come on in, girl. Leave all that behind. But you've got to work fast because you've got to get out in 10 minutes.
Hey, Tomato, wake up. Are they going to fix the bed?
Say, I'd like two pillows on that bed there,
huh? All right,
bring them. Say, there's a slight misunderstanding here. I said the girl's going to work fast, not your friend.
He's still asleep.
You know, he does better asleep than I do awake.
No, he's half asleep.
Yes, he's half asleep and half not. Yes? I'm the engineer.
I'm here to turn off the heat.
Well, you can start right in on him.
Wake up, Tomaso. Tomaso, we're going to eat soon.
You know, if it wasn't for Gottlieb, I wouldn't have got this room. Just hold him there a second. Yes?
Did you want a manicure?
No, come on in. I hadn't planned on a manicure, but I think on a journey like this, you ought to have every convenience you can get. You're not getting the manicure. Get out of here, will you?
Did you want your nails long or short?
You better make them short. It's getting kind of crowded with you. I don't know. This isn't the way I pictured an ocean voyage. I always visualized myself sitting in a steamer chair with a steward bringing me bouillon.
Come on, Ricardo.
You couldn't get any bouillon in here unless they brought it in through a keyhole. I'm
the engineer's assistant.
You know, I had a premonition you were going to show up. The engineer's right over there in the corner. You can chop your way right through. Say, is it my imagination or is it getting crowded here? Yeah,
I got plenty of room.
Yes?
Minnie in here.
Well, you can come in and prowl around if you want to. If she isn't here, you can probably find somebody just as good.
Well, could I use your phone?
Use the phone? I'll lay even money you can't get in the room.
How do you do?
This boat will be in New York before you can get to that phone.
I came to mop up.
Just the woman I'm looking for. Well, that gone on the ceiling is the only place that isn't being occupied. Tell Aunt Minnie to send up a bigger room, too, isn't it?
How many people were in that room?
Just Groucho and 23 dummies.
Tell me about the later films that you made and the end of the act, before you all ventured off into solo careers.
Well, after we worked with Thalberg, the picture started to slip a little bit. You know, we weren't young men anymore. We'd been doing this act in one form or another since we were children. And by the time we made some of the later ones, At the Circus, Go West, The Big Store, we were past our period as a team. I went on to work in television and wrote several books and did other things. But the Marx brothers were by definition young and vital. And at some point in the mid-30s, it was just time to stop doing it. I remember we were working on A Night in Casablanca. We were shooting a very complicated stunt comedy sequence, and Harpo and I were both hanging on to the end of an airplane as it made its way down the runway. We were in our 60s. I looked at Harpo, I said, have you had enough? And he says, yes.
Here's an image that I found while doing research of Chico in 1909, and then underneath an image of Marcel Duchamp, almost in the same pose in 1917. Yeah. I've always thought of the Marx brothers being very related to Marcel Duchamp in form of their anti-authoritarian sense of humor. Were you aware of Marcel Duchamp at all?
Somewhat, and I was very aware that the surrealists always sort of took to the Marx brothers. They liked us, not only Duchamp, but Otto, and some of our fingers, and it's kind of silly to waste time on that, wasn't it? And Salvador Dali wrote a screenplay for us. Did you know that Dali wrote a script for the Marx Brothers? He was very taken with us, particularly Harpo. The screenplay was incoherent and unproducible. Dali illustrated this screenplay with several drawings. One was a drawing of Harpo playing the harp, and the harp had an enormous tongue. Then another one, Dali drew a picture of me with six arms. That's a laugh riot, isn't it, folks? Oh, you've got to see the new Marx Brothers movie. Groucho has six arms in this one. And Duchamp, sure, the surrealists appreciated us because there was something absurd about the Marx Brothers. There was an element of the overthrow of reason in our comedy. The difference, though, is that the surrealists were appealing on an intellectual level without being funny. The Marx Brothers were not intellectually appealing. But they were funny.
This is a piece by Duchamp where he famously painted a mustache on what is arguably the most famous work in the history of art, the Mona Lisa.
L-H-O-O-Q. I had that same picture when I had my eyes examined.
Tell me a little bit.
How long did he spend on this, I wonder? Did he pace in his studio for days? Looking at nothing but a blank canvas with the Mona Lisa painted on it. First he tried a full beard. No, not quite right. Bushy eyebrows.
So there's not only a relationship to sort of like the absurd tradition in the arts, but of course also to other comedians of that time. You guys were really much of pioneers in the early days of filmmaking.
Yes.
And what was your relationship to other comedians of the time? Here, for example, Buster Keaton or Charles Chaplin.
Well, we were fond of many of our peers, and it was a wonderful age of comedy. For me, Chaplin will always be the best. There's never been anybody like Chaplin on the screen or on the stage. I saw him first on the stage before World War I in Toronto in a show called A Night in an English Music Hall. He knocked me out. I said, that's the funniest man I've ever seen, and my opinion never changed. We were friendly and saw each other occasionally. Chaplin once said to me, it amused me so much to have Chaplin say to me one day, I wish I could talk on the screen the way you can. There's never been a better comedian than Chaplin, and what he could do physically with his body was remarkable. And there he was envying me because I could talk on the screen. I guess I'm a little better than Chaplin. Buster Keaton was a gag man on some of our later pictures. You know, by the time we got to MGM, Buster's career was for the most part finished, and he was a gag man. He devised jokes for Harpo on At the Circus. He was a great comedian too.
When we're thinking about the legacy of the Marx Brothers, one comedian that particularly comes to my mind is Jim Carrey. Are you familiar at all with his work?
Yes, I'm aware of his work. I'm aware of a lot of the young comedians. There's a lot of talented people out there today, but one thing that I'm always surprised by is how dirty they all are. It's all gotten so dirty. I remember being invited to see O Calcutta on Broadway. I decided I'll just stay in the room, take off my clothes, and look in the mirror, save $20. Back then we were cleaner and cuter. But there's always talent. There's always good comedians out there. And I suppose the Marx Brothers were influential. I can see our influence all over. And I'm getting a little sick of it, too.
Is there anything else you can tell me a little bit about the development of comedy in the 20th century since you and your brothers performed?
The same things always make an audience laugh. It never changes. There are subtle variations over the years, and new comedians come up with a new spin. But the same basic things always make us laugh. It's the combination of competence, of confidence, and ineptitude. There's never been anything funnier than that. We were always confident and inept. And those are the same things that make an audience laugh in the theater today. There's very little difference. But as I say, it has gotten much dirtier. And I think there's an appetite for wordplay in the culture today that I haven't seen since we were in our prime. Some of the comedians are terribly clever.
Perhaps as a last question before I open up to the audience, has there any movie been out there in the last couple of decades where you said, like, this would have been a movie Groucho would have been perfect for?
Well, let me think about that for a moment. A movie that Groucho would have been perfect for. You know, everyone wanted to work with me. I turned down some good pictures that I should have done. Like, Fellini wanted to make a picture with me. He wanted me to be in Satyricon. But I didn't want to go live in Italy for 3 months. Billy Wilder wanted to make a picture with us, and it never quite worked out. The only recent picture I can think of, in the last 20, 30 years anyway, that really captures the spirit of the Marx Brothers, it's Remains of the Day. It doesn't seem like it, but if you watch it with that in mind, you can't miss it.
Well, let's see what the questions we have from the audience.
You may fire when ready.
Thank you so much. If I bet my life, can I get it back, double or nothing? Either outcome would be fine.
Well, there's always a comedian in the crowd somewhere, isn't there? Must be a dirty one. He doesn't even want to read that one, folks. That's a good one. You'll tell it to me later, right?
Well, this one is very straightforward. Do you watch TV at all? And if so, what do you enjoy the most?
I find television very educational. As soon as someone turns it on, I go into the other room and read a book.
Which one of their brothers was the easiest to work with? Have there ever been any quarrels?
Well, the easiest to work with, I would say, was Harpo. But we always worked well together. We never had any sort of rows on stage. We had a little bit of disagreement sometimes relating to the management of the act and Chico's responsibility and so on. But on stage, we always worked like clockwork together.
Do you ever figure out how the elephant got into the pajamas?
I never did. I never did figure it out. That was a wonderful speech in Animal Crackers that George Kaufman and Maury Riskin wrote for me about exploring Africa. I said, so we left New York drunk and early on the morning of February 2nd. We lost 2 days crossing the 59th Street Bridge. That was how it started, and it included the elephant joke. I won't bother you with it right now, but the follow-up to it, I think, is one of the best puns I ever heard. I said, after shooting this elephant, we tried to remove the tusks, but they were embedded in so firmly that we couldn't budge them. Of course, in Alabama, the Tuscaloosa. And I think that's as good a pun as I've ever heard. You can take a little time with it if you like. It's nice. Of course, in Alabama, the Tuscaloosa. More questions.
More questions. Whatever happened to the duck?
The duck from the quiz show. You bet your life. Yeah, say the secret word and the duck will come down and pay you $100. It's a common word, something you see every day. I don't know, the duck probably wound up in a museum or maybe stuffed and mounted somewhere. What does this say? Some priceless silver has been stolen from the museum's collection. I don't want to alarm anybody, but according to this, some priceless heirloom silver has been stolen from the museum's collection. If I've ever seen a guilty face, it's that one right there. Come here, we got to get to the bottom of this. You know, I'm Captain Scotland of Spalding Yard. Are you responsible for this thievery? You have a terribly guilty face. Oh, I'm sorry. I know you wouldn't do such a thing. You're obviously honest. Come here, let me apologize to you. I'm terribly sorry. I can tell an honest, round-eyed boy like you could never do anything like that. Why, it's obvious every time I look at you that you're the most decent and humble, that it's boys like you who make the country a wonderful place. When I look at you, I can just see. I can just see that you're trustworthy. Why, I would buy anything you were selling. And I can tell that you're as honest as the day is long. And I'm talking about a long day, too. This may go on for years. Well, you certainly surprised me. I thought you had more than that. But you know, I am going to have to take you in. My brother Harpo.
You once famously said that you would never join a club that would accept you as a member.
Yes.
How did you find a cemetery that allowed you to be buried there?
Well, I was dying to get a good spot there. Kindly submit your complaints in writing. Yes, I would not join a club that would accept me for a member. On another occasion, I was at a restricted club. I didn't realize it was restricted, but I was trying to join. And they told my daughter, Miriam, she couldn't go in the pool. I said, well, she's only half Jewish. Can she go in up to her knees?
Let me see what else I have here. Well, we had that.
Dirty.
Elephant.
No, phone number. I'll talk to you later. I took one look at you, that's all I meant to do, and then my heart stood still. Isn't that lovely? You know what that song means? It means I took one look at you and dropped dead.
You have to help me with this one here.
Ah, let's see. This is an excellent question. The question is, I think I might have another brother in the audience tonight. What has two pair of pants, lives in Philadelphia, and it never rains but it pours? The answer is Ulysses S. Grant. It's very simple. The question is, what has two pair of pants, lives in Philadelphia, and it never rains but it pours? And the answer is, who's buried in Grant's tomb? Listen, we can end this thing right now if you like. I'll wrestle anyone in the crowd for $5. Would anyone like to buy a year subscription to the Youth Companion? I'm paying my way through college. Would anyone like a 6-month subscription? I'll go to high school.
Jenna, do we have any more questions? Yeah, we have a few more questions.
There's another one here. They're just coming in like wildfire.
There's one more.
Remember, the more the question is worth, the harder it is.
Now we have a whole pile here. How many times have you been married?
I've been married 3 times. Each time for about 100 years. You want to know the secret of marriage? I'll tell you. The key to a happy life, ladies and gentlemen, you have to find a partner who makes you laugh. You have to find a partner who takes care of you. And you have to find a partner who you're sexually attracted to. And it's very important that these three partners not find out about each other.
Tell us a little bit about the musical from 1924, the lost musical that you
I'll say she is. Well, we were at a very low ebb when that show came along. We had done as much as we possibly could in vaudeville. We were palace regulars. We had climbed to the very top of the ladder, and it seemed like there was nothing more we could do. What we wanted was a Broadway show, because it meant you could stay in New York, live at home, and just do a show every night. It seemed like a very soft racket for boys who had been on the road for 20 years since they were children. And we were tired of touring. The road was grueling and tiresome. And we kept trying to appear in a legitimate musical. But all of our musicals were illegitimate. Finally, along came a producer. His name was Joseph M. Gates. The M stood for minimum. And he had rewritten an old show, which was called Give Me a Thrill. It was about a society woman looking for thrills. And the Marx Brothers played the men who were trying to give her a thrill. And we toured that show for almost an entire year in the country before opening on Broadway. The producers always had a plan. You'd run on Broadway for 2 weeks and then tour the country for years, direct from Broadway. But unexpectedly, we were a big hit, and it was the beginning of the Marx Brothers. The most famous scene in I'll Say She Is was the Napoleon scene. I played Napoleon, Lotta Miles played Josephine, and Harpo, Chico, and Zeppo played Josephine's lovers, who are always scattering to the four corners of the room when Napoleon enters. That was the scene, essentially, that put the Marx Brothers on the map. And I was associated with the role of Napoleon for years. You can see it now.
Here's a special request. Will you sing Lydia the Tattooed Lady for us?
Well, I don't know if you really want to hear an a cappella Lydia. I'll give you a little bit of it. The beginning of the song goes, Lydia, oh Lydia, say, have you met Lydia? Lydia the Tattooed Lady. She has eyes that folks adore so, and a torso even more so. Lydia, oh Lydia, that encyclopedia. Lydia the Queen of Tattoo. On her back is the Battle of Waterloo. Beside it, the wreck of the Hesperus too. And proudly above waves the red, white, and blue. You can learn a lot from Lydia.
I'm not familiar with this, but can you comment on the play A Day in Hollywood, A Night in the Ukraine?
Yes, A Day in Hollywood, A Night in the Ukraine. This was a Broadway musical, half of which was a sort of pastiche of the Marx Brothers. I thought it was very clever. It was as though they were writing a new piece for us. That was the A Night in the Ukraine section of the show. The first part was just a musical review, sort of old Hollywood songs. It was very clever. There have been many good Marx Brothers pastiches. There was a show called Minnie's Boys on Broadway years ago. It was the story of our early years. And my son Arthur wrote the book for it. And numerous productions of Coconuts and Animal Crackers have been seen. And I'm thrilled to see that the work keeps going and that I don't have to do it anymore. One more dirty question. Little rascal.
You can read that.
This says, remember your best punchline. Oh yes, of course. Your writing is perfectly legible. It's my reading.
The right.
This was a famous line. This was on the quiz show. This never actually aired because it was too obscene to air. You'll be happy to hear. But it did take place in the studio, and anyone who was there remembers it. You know, I would interview the contestants on this quiz show. They were just normal, everyday people who we take out of the audience. Like you, but normal. And this woman, her name was Mrs. Story. And Mrs. Story had 21 children. I said, well, Mrs. Story, how do you explain this prodigious output? Why on earth do you have 21 children? And she said, well, you know, I believe that we were put on earth to be fruitful and multiply, and besides, I love my husband. I said, I like my cigar too, but I take it out once in a while. But all the young comedians are too dirty nowadays. Never got bleeped, never saw air.
Because it's metaphorical, it's Yiddish humor.
There is an element of Jewish humor to it. And there was another thing like that. In Animal Crackers, in the song Hooray for Captain Spaulding, they sing, Hooray for Captain Spaulding, the African explorer. And my line was, did someone call me Schnorrer?
How much would you say that the Marx Brothers humor is Jewish humor?
Well, it was not explicitly Jewish most of the time. This was because in vaudeville you had to tour the entire country and you might find yourself in a town where they'd never seen a Jewish person. So doing jokes that depended on knowledge of the Jewish experience wouldn't fly. In fact, we had a joke in our vaudeville act, this must be the Far Rockaway boat, I can smell the herring. Very funny on 93rd Street. But I don't think there was any question about a certain Jewish attitude in our work. We were culturally very sensitive about Judaism, and it was important to us. Hoppe left his harp to the State of Israel. You can go there and see it now. And we never had any inclination to deny being Jewish. And occasionally on the quiz show, I would drop a little Yiddish. By that time, it had become assimilated into the language. But to say that my character was inherently Jewish seems almost an insult to the Jewish people.
Well, Groucho, thanks so much for coming and
to see us. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
Do you have any last piece of advice for us to take with us into the night?
Well, I've had a wonderful evening, but this wasn't it.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure.